All right, so good evening. It's good to be here. It's a little bit intimidating because there's all kinds of people who have a really great electronical background. So I don't know how long this presentation will last, but let's see. Let's hope it is within an hour. Since this is being broadcast, I was actually planning on saving the bulk of the questions to the end of the presentation. But if you have anything really important to share, then go ahead. So this is a talk about the Gigaton, which is the TTL microcomputer. That's actually the brain behind the project. Marcel, he's here, and I'm here being the talking head. And it all started about a year ago when Marcel bought some stuff, some TTL logic chips, soldering iron, oscilloscope. And okay, so now we have these tools. What can you do with a bunch of microchips? Can you do something interesting? Can you do an interesting hack? So these chips are actually quite old and quite simple. They contain really basic logic like AND gates, NOR gates, sometimes a little bit more complex like multiplexers and stuff, but not really, they don't do really a lot by themselves. Now these chips were used in the 70s and the 80s by people like this guy, Steve Wozniak. There's this famous story when he was working, when his friend Steve Jobs was working at Atari, and Atari was building a new computer game, and they were trying to get the amount of chips less than what it used to be. So those arcade machines would be built out of TTL chips, single logic chips, and a typical game would contain about 190 of those chips. And they wanted to decrease the amount of chips, and they got a bonus for every chip that they lost in the design. So Steve Jobs asked Steve Wozniak, and he spent two nights straight to reduce the amount of chips. And in the end, he was able to do it in 42 chips to implement the game Breakout. The game is actually in black and white. So these are color overlays that are put on top of the black and white screen. And in the actual, so I think it was 42 chips. And in the end, they had to smuggle in a few extra to get it reliable, and then when Atari made a product out of it, they needed 100 chips in the end to make it really into a product. And this is the actual board that was made, the original Breakout board. So this is really simple stuff. This is really simple electronics. There's no microprocessor. It's just a simple gates and buffers and registers and multiplexers and stuff. Now, of course, Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs continued, and they built their first computer, the Apple One. And this one did have a microprocessor. So this has the MOS 6502 processor that you can see over here. And so here's a schematic of what's inside of the processor, an algorithmic unit, instruction register, and all kinds of other stuff. And this board also has not that many components, but it does have the CPU. So this is a CPU computer running at 1 MHz. 4K ROM, RAM, and well, you could do some basic stuff with that. So this was July 1976 when the first Apple One was produced. So let's get back to the components. So these are a few that I found in my own attic. What's interesting is that these components have a production date. So this is 1976, week 19. This is 1975, week 52. These are quite old. Can we still do something useful with that, with the chips that stem from a time when we were looking like this? So back then, in 1975, 76, it was really hard to build your own electronic stuff. You really needed to be a whiz kid. Fortunately, nowadays, there's all kinds of tooling that will help you to build those computers. So we have breadboards, we have software to design PCBs, and it's become much more easy to do interesting projects. So as I said, this whole project started a year ago when Marcel bought some kind of stuff and he started building stuff on his breadboard, and this was the end result of the prototyping stage on the breadboard. And this is actually a computer. So the question, what can we do with these TTL logic chips? It turns out the answer is you can build an actual working computer out of it without a CPU. So that's all implemented using these basic components. Of course, this looks a bit sloppy, so after this stage, the next stage was to build build it in hardware, build it with a real PCB. And this is the stage we are at now. So the remainder of this talk, I would like to talk about how a computer works and especially how this computer works. Right, so if you implement a computer, there are certain design decisions you can make. And we did make a few design decisions, and I'll go through all of those. Right, a computer. A computer contains a central processing unit, which it would be easy to get a CPU for that, but we implemented in TTL logic, as I said. And this contains an arithmetic logic unit that can do basic calculations. There is a control unit that is the thing that controls what is happening inside of the CPU. We have some in-CPU memory containing registers and cache. We have inputs going into the computer, outputs going out, and there's external and internal memory. External memory we skipped altogether. This can be a floppy drive or hard disk or whatever. There's no external memory in our system. We have just internal memory connected to the CPU. Now, the internal memory, we can use an EEPROM. We do use an EEPROM, which is a ROM containing containing data, and we have a RAM chip that can be written to and read from. We also need input and output. For input, the idea was, well, let's put in some switches. And for the output, well, what about a nice LED matrix to do some really nice blinking lights? So this was the basic design. Now, the first thing is, if you have your program in the ROM and you need to access the RAM, how do you do this? This needs to go via the CPU. And actually, if you want to combine those, there's a few ways of doing this. There's two basic architectures that you can use. First, there's the von Neumann architecture. And this was named after a guy called von Neumann, who in the late 1940s was in a team building, I can't remember if it was the EDSEC or the ENIAC computer, I think the EDSEC. And that used a new architecture, and there were a few people writing a paper about it, and it got the name of von Neumann, so that's how it's been called. And in this setup, we have the internal memory that contains program and data. So that's all together in the same memory, and that's what we are using on our day-to-day computers normally. So a standard PC will have RAM that will contain a piece of program and a piece of data. Combining the program, the actual instructions, the program instructions and the data has, of course, security effects. You can have self-modifying code, you can have buffer overflows because the data and the program are intermixed in the same memory. Another way of doing this, and this was popular before the von Neumann architecture, but it's still used, is the Harvard architecture, where you have two connections between the CPU and the memory. And you split up the program memory containing the actual instructions, and you have a separate data memory in which you can store results and read from and write to. So this is a simple design. The downside, there's always a downside, is that you don't have direct access from the ROM to the RAM. So if you have a program in ROM and you want to put something into the RAM, you need to go via the CPU, and it's a bit more of a hassle. But, and here's another way of looking at the Harvard architecture. So you see the control unit, which is the overall machine that controls what's happening in the computer, has access to the program memory, data memory, separate memories, I/O, and the arithmetic unit. And of course, in our design, we had these two chips, the EEPROM chip, which holds the actual instructions, and we have a RAM chip, which holds the data memory. Okay. So how do we get these instructions to do something? So the EEPROM holds the instructions, and they come out of there by having a counter, program counter. Yes?
You have chosen the Harvard architecture for this project.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yes, so this is the architecture we've implemented. And the EEPROM, so then the EEPROM only holds the instructions, and those are read one by one because there's a program counter pointing at the next instruction. So we can go through all the instructions in the EEPROM that need to be executed. So this was the first of the many design choices. As I said, there's pros and cons for each of them. And the Harvard architecture is much more simple if you look at the hardware. And for us, we decided to keep the hardware as simple as we can. We want this to be a simple board. And in many cases, and we will see many more cases, if you have simple hardware, it's still possible to do to get a lot of functionality by making the software a little bit more complicated. Some problems that you get, or complexity that you get because of simple hardware, you can solve by making software a little bit more complex. Okay, so if we look at the board, we'll see that here is the program counter. So this is pointing at the next instruction in the EEPROM. Here is a clock circuit. This clock circuit will just tick in a certain frequency and will increment the program counter. The program counter points at an address in the EEPROM. So every clock tick, we will get an instruction out of the EEPROM. Of course, we also need some power stuff. So we've built in a little bit of power circuitry. So this is being powered by using standard USB plug. And there's some extra electronics to make sure that if people short the board, nothing will actually break. Now this EEPROM is then, so we point using the program counter into the EEPROM and out comes an instruction. So what do we do next with this instruction? We can go again in two different directions. We can choose for a RISC architecture, reduced instruction set, where one instruction is really simple and only does one thing in the CPU. The other way of doing stuff is using CISC, complex instruction set, which means that one instruction can be quite complicated, which means that the CPU actually takes multiple steps for one instruction. So those are micro instructions. And actually that requires a lot of hardware. You need to do a micro code conversion. You need to look up in a table what micro instructions you need to do for a certain instruction and then do these in several steps. So if you have the 6502 microprocessor, it's a CISC architecture and you have maybe up to 7 steps per instruction. So if you have a really complicated instruction, the CPU will go through 7 cycles to operate, to execute that instruction. And here you see a Z80 processor, and you can see a large part of the die is devoted to doing all this stuff, instruction decoding. So that's pretty complicated. This is a instruction set for a ARM processor, and here you see that they have chosen, no, this is?
PIC12.
PIC processor. And here you see instructions are all the same size. So this is RISC. And if you look at, for instance, this is also Z80, you see that the instructions can differ in size. So some instructions are just 1 byte and some are more bytes. So that's more complicated. And I believe in modern systems, if you have an 80x86, you can have 1 to up to 17 cycles of microcode within one instruction. So it's obvious we choose for a simple solution in hardware and we solve this problem with making a little bit more complicated software or having a little bit more work to get the software right. So we chose RISC, the RISC architecture. So we now have a EEPROM outcome instructions and they need to do something. And we not only need instructions, we also need operands. We need some data to have these instructions work with. Now in the original breadboard, we didn't have an EEPROM, but we had a ROM. And there were actually 2 ROMs. One ROM containing all the instructions and a separate ROM containing all the operands. Another design decision is to have instructions of a fixed length, RISC, and for each instruction have one operand also in a fixed length. Each instruction has one operand. And so they come out of these chips in parallel. So for each clock tick, we have a new instruction and we have a new operand. Even if the instruction doesn't need an operand, every instruction gets an operand. So that's quite simple from the hardware perspective. Now we could use, in the final design, we could have used 2 ROM chips or 2 EEPROMs that both output 8 bits. This is an 8-bit system. But in the end, we chose for an EEPROM that outputs 16 bits. So we have actually shove those two chips together into one. So every clock tick, the EEPROM spits out 16 bits, of which we say that the first 8 are the instruction and the second 8 are the data. So in this case, in the EEPROM, in every location, we have instruction operand, and it's the way how the EEPROM is filled. Now, what's interesting in the architecture is that we fetch from the EEPROM an instruction and an operand, and then the system will execute that instruction. But, is that what I meant to say? So in each cycle, we can fetch one instruction and one operand, and that's every cycle, because we have RISC. But we can parallelize, and during the execution, we can already fetch the next instruction. So every clock tick, an instruction is being fetched. Now this has a peculiar consequence, and that is pipelining. Right, so because these steps are done simultaneously, that means that if I'm executing an instruction, the next one has already been fetched and is ready to be operated. So these instructions are and operands are stored in buffers that are over there on the board. Now this fetching of the next instruction during the execution of a previous one is normally not a problem, but if you have a branch instruction, something weird happens. Right, so here we have a program that says we load the accumulator with 0, and a bit later on we do a branch to 0, but you see the next instruction is a knob. That instruction, it has already been fetched at the time that the branch is being executed.
Oh, there's no branch prediction yet.
Sorry?
Branch prediction yet.
Branch prediction, no. So that knob is actually executed after the branch. So you have to take this into account. It's not a really a big deal. You can solve this in software. Or you can use clever tricks to make use of this. Right. So in this case, in the second program, I have an instruction that is being loaded and is being executed, but this is actually an instruction that I want to have executed. So with some clever coding, I can make sure that no clock tick is going to waste. So this is done in software. It's interesting because if you have a Spark processor, you also have pipelining, and in Spark you need to take care of this. And if you have ARM, you also have pipelining, but in the ARM architecture, those instructions are being removed, they are being deleted.
If it's a conditional branch, then you also have a conditional load instruction, or is it not part of your...
Yes, if you have a conditional branch, it becomes really interesting.
Yes,
Then it will get executed.
It will always be executed, but you don't. But either way, you end up to the next instruction or in the branch. Yeah. So if you have a compiler that compiles into assembly, you can use clever tricks to make use of this. So that's why I say keep the hardware simple, and we can solve this or actually use this in software. So let's look again at the main picture of the EEPROM: program counter, outcome, instruction, and an operand. And let's take a closer look at the instructions that come out. So what do they do? And actually, the instruction is, of course, the thing that operates the whole computer. It determines what I'm going to do. And what can the computer do? We have a control over what the ALU is doing. What is the algorithmic unit calculating? What do I do with the registers? What do I do with input-output? Who gets access to the bus? Do I need to do something with the program counter? That can all be operated in hardware by reading the instruction. And because we are building a new computer, we can make up our own rules of what each instruction does. There's a few bits. One bit is missing, I see. The first two bits were decided to mean this is who gets access to the data bus on the system. The second, the third, fourth, and fifth bit are for the address mode or the branch condition. I will explain a lot more about this in a minute. And the last three bits are the actual instruction. What do we calculate? And of course, this was up to us, how many bits to use for what, and this was what we came up with. Now, the bus access, so those first two bits, they determine what data is being written to the bus. And who reads that, we'll come to later. But there are four possibilities, and we have two bits. So the first is that we use the operand and put that on the bus. The second is we read the RAM and put it on the bus. The third is the accumulator value goes to the bus. And the last one is the input register goes to the bus. So we do have hardware inputs that we'll explain later on. Here are the buffers that buffer the contents to be put onto the bus. So we have one for input, etc., ALU. And what's also interesting is that we actually only have the only register that you can put on the bus is the input or the ALU, and we don't have many registers in the system. So some CPU designs have a whole lot of registers. But we like to keep it simple. So we have a program counter, we have an instruction register, an operand register, the buffer, an accumulator, which holds the result of the calculation in the ALU. And we have some other registers, an in and out register, and we have an X and Y register. And those are used to point at a certain place in the RAM chip. And also, the X and Y register, for instance, they cannot be read because that would also complicate things. Those can only be written to, but they are used to point to a certain place in RAM. So if I'm going to put something in those registers, I know what's in there. So there's not really a need for me to be able to read them as well. So the accumulator is the main register where we do calculations and can do stuff.
No stack pointer?
No stack pointer. So here are the here you see the accumulator and the X and the Y register. The X register is two chips and the Y register is one, and there's a reason for that, which I will explain shortly. So the first two bits are who puts data onto the bus. Then we have the last three bits. Those are that's the instruction that you're doing. So we have a few of those, and the middle part is the address mode if you are doing one of these instructions. Actually, the three middle bits have a dual purpose. So if the instruction is one of those, then the middle bits are the address mode. So what does that mean? We have an ALU, and the ALU does arithmetic, and it always takes the accumulator and the bus as inputs, and it does some kind of a calculation, and out comes a result. What's also interesting is that here it says an arrow saying out comes a state. So in normal CPU designs, you have a register with all kinds of flags, if it's positive or negative or carry or all kinds of stuff. We don't have that. There's only a carry bit. The address mode is actually also dual purpose in itself. It determines the address that points to in the RAM chip. So where are we pointing in the RAM chip? And it determines where the ALU result is going to. So it does two things. So RAM address means, so if I choose 100, that means that the bits zero and the bits that are in the operand will determine the address that's being pointed at in the RAM chip. So that's one thing. And the other thing is that it determines where the ALU result is going to. So in this case, it will be the X register. Now there's one special one. Here we see that we can use as RAM address Y and X plus plus. So X is automatically incremented by one. And for this, you need to calculate something. Well, we don't calculate it. We use a counter as the X register. So that's why the X register is two chips and the Y is only one, because the X register can actually count. So you can, in one instruction, can add one to the X. And this is really useful to go over a bunch of RAM addresses, which we will need to get some interesting output later on.
Post increment?
post document. Yeah. So, for that example over there, you see that the first two bits are 0, 1. So this means the RAM address, the RAM output is put to the bus. Well, which RAM address are we using? That's coming from the middle three bits. In this case, it's using the wire register and the operand to point at a certain position in the RAM. So the RAM goes to the bus. Y and D determine where in the RAM I'm reading from. And the last three bits say that the ALU is going to do an... And this one is also saying that the result of the operation is going into the accumulator. And then add is telling the ALU to do an addition. Okay. The LD is the only one that doesn't really do anything. It just takes the bus value and puts it in the accumulator, and all the others do an actual arithmetic operation. Right. So here you see the actual wiring of the board that tells the CPU, well, there's no CPU, that tells the computer what to do when you get a certain instruction. So this is done using diodes. So it's actually a bit like a ROM, a lookup table. And this directs the bits to the correct places in the hardware to do the right stuff. So that's an instruction decoder and an address mode decoder. Now there are two more instructions. There's the store instruction. And the store is the only instruction with which you can actually write data into RAM. And there's the branch instruction. And if you have the branch instruction, then the middle bits are not the address mode, but the branch condition. So this determines when you do the branch or not. And since we have three bits, we have eight possibilities. And these are the ones that we use. So we have a branch never, which is not really useful, but we have rewired it to do something useful, which I'll explain in a minute. And we have a few other conditions for the branch.
So you cannot branch to a value of the X or Y register. You cannot calculate the address.
No.
The branch to that. Oh, okay.
Well, but hold on. So if you look at this table, it's actually looking from hardware, rather easy to do. So we look at, is the accumulator less than zero, greater than zero, or zero? And by doing an OR, you can get all these combinations. Right, so if you want to know if the accumulator is bigger than or equal to zero, you do an OR of it's zero or it's bigger than zero. So here you get this truth table from. And how do we do this? Well, if we look at the highest bit of the accumulator, and we look to see if that's 0 or 1, we know if it is a positive or negative number. And to calculate if the accumulator is 0, that was kind of tricky, because in normal CPU designs there's a lot of hardware involved to check all the bits and to see if something is 0. But Marcel had a great idea, and he said, well, if we have the accumulator, we can let it do an operation. Let's do it, let's make a negation of the accumulator. And if that has a carry, then you know that the original number was zero. Did you say that right? Yeah. And otherwise, it's not zero. It does not have a carry. So by doing this one operation, you can figure out if the accumulator is zero. And by that, you can fill this complete truth table. So that's really it's really cool to have this with really not much hardware to get all these possibilities. So here are the instructions. So the first six are instructions that do something with the ALU, do some calculation. The store instruction, we don't use the accumulator, but in the same time, we can let the accumulator do something. So it's wired to let the ALU calculate the accumulator. So the result is that we can use this cycle to also store the accumulator in the RAM somewhere. And with the branch instruction, as I said, we calculate the negation of the accumulator, so we can figure out if the value is zero or not. Now, this could also have been done by using specialized chips for that. So there are ALU chips, and those are 4-bit, so we would have used two of those. And those are really complicated. So one of these chips contains 75 logic elements. And also it's a really big chip, so it doesn't look very sexy on the board. So we have really dug down into how the how this can be made with simple electronics. Actually, the way the ALU actually works with this simple stuff is worth a talk in itself. It's quite interesting how it works, but not in this talk. So the ALU is over here. So there is 8 bits. And the total is 10 chips for the accumulator using really standard stuff. And here again are the addressing modes. So we have the X and Y registers where the X can be automatically incremented. So this is sort of a zero page direct mode where we use zero and the operand value. We have a zero page indirect using the X register, and we have a page Y direct and a page Y indirect addressing mode. So we have several modes. And for this, we have these chips. So if you look at the memory, if you look at the EEPROM memory, the ROM memory, then we have the problem with branch addressing that we cannot branch out of our page. So we can branch to a certain value in our page, but not to a different page. Right. So if we are executing instruction somewhere here, we can go back and forth, but not further. How to solve this? This you can solve in software. So you can get to the next row. You need software, but sorry. I'm going a step too fast. What I was going to say is, this is quite, this is absolute addressing within the page, right? So if you want to say, I want to jump 5 instructions further, you cannot do that because you don't have the +5. You can only jump to an absolute address within your page. So that's a bit cumbersome, but you can solve that in software, right? So that's software. But we also want to jump to another page. So that's the problem, because we don't have an instruction to do this.
Your program counter can't cross the page boundary, right?
Well, you can, if you are here and you have a next instruction, you go to the next page. So, yeah, but to get back then, that would require a lot of steps. But we had this logic table with all the branches, and we have one branch that branched never. So that's not a very useful instruction. Mm-hmm. So we are going to rewire this instruction to do something actually useful. So the never condition, we rewire in hardware to do a far jump, which is what we were missing. So this is no longer do not branch ever, but this means branch far, and far means we use the Y register for the high bits. So you can put something in the Y register, the page, and then you can do a far jump to that page and then to an absolute address. So now we have the whole branching stuff working in quite simple hardware.
Do you not have a branch radius to the...
A branch?
Branch radius to the program counter.
A branch relative to the program counter. No, that's not possible.
You need a separate ALU for
calculation. So that's why I said in cases where we can simplify the hardware, we do so. And the functionality that you need to do relative branches, we do that by in the software.
Also no branch prediction.
And then, so that's the basic CPU in TTL logic. How about input and output? That's fairly simple. For output, you just take the ALU result and put it somewhere out. So you have 8 bits of output that you can do something with. And we already had this addressing mode where it says the bus goes to the output chip. So that's the output. Now the input. We have also a buffer chip that can contain 8 bits as input, and we need a way to copy that to the bus and we also have an addressing mode for that. Yes, so if I want to do output, I use this address mode that says the ALU result goes to the output chip. There are two possibilities of doing so. And if I want to do input, I need to specify my bus access that I want to have the input on the bus. And then I can do load or store or whatever to do something with the value on the bus. So that's basically the input and output. So we have 8 bits of input, 8 bits of output. And we could try to output the LED matrix. But round about that time, there were some postings on the internet of people using Arduinos to do VGA output. And that sounded really interesting. And VGA is not as difficult as you might think. It's 640 by 480 if you do EGA with 64 colors. So this, for 64 colors, you need 6 bits of output. And you need to output these pixels, 6 bit. And you need to have H-sync signals for each scan line. There's an H-sync, and for each screen, there's a V-sync signal that you need to provide. And what's hard to do it in the correct timing. So the timing is really critical, but if you have the correct timing and the correct H-sync and V-sync signals, you have a valid VGA signal. Since we use RISC, and we know that each instruction is exactly one clock cycle, it should be fairly easy to output all the stuff in the correct timing to get a correct VGA signal. But then, of course, you need to adapt the timing to match the VGA signal. So that's the reason we're using a 6.25 megahertz clock. And that works wonderfully well. All the hardware works on that speed. And we can use this to output the VGA signal. And that's the reason why we have the X register as counter. So it's really easy to quickly push out data from RAM onto the output. So here you see a picture of the H-sync and V-sync signals from one of the prototypes. And a bit of a problem by outputting VGA is that it takes up a lot of processing power. So if you look at the VGA timing signal, there is each scan line contains a lot of pixels, and then there's some space left that is not shown on the screen where you have time to do some actual useful stuff, as long as you don't forget to do the H-sync every line. And then below the last scan line, there are some more invisible scan lines that you can also use to do some interesting stuff, as long as you don't forget to put in the V-sync. So the red part is where the screen is being built, and the green part is where we have time left to do some useful stuff. So timing is critical, and there's actually two approaches you can do. You could build some kind of interpreter or compiler that takes code and compiles it into something, keeping into account the timing issues, which you can then load onto the system. But in this case, it was chosen to build an interpreter that takes opcodes or instructions from the ROM, sees if it still has time to execute a few of them, execute them, and get back into a loop to see if something needs to be done with VGA or if we can do a few more operands. So it is a little bit slower on the overall execution, but still the system is fast enough. So again, we use software to solve this this problem.
This interpreter is actually on the machine?
This interpreter is on the machine, yeah.
In hardware?
No, in ROM. So it's all flashed in ROM. So in ROM, we have the interpreter and we have the code we actually want to run. Okay. And the interpreter will make sure that the code is run and the VGA signal is done and everything is working fine. Because of the speed of the RAM, which is a limiting factor, and also the amount of RAM that we need to make a 640 by 480 screen, we use 160 pixels instead of 640. So we divide by 4. So every pixel is actually the size of 4 pixels. Of 4 regular pixels. And we repeat the scan line 4 times to save on memory. Or what we can do is we can write each scan line, we can write 3 scan lines and then leave 1 empty. This has a bit of a retro look, so we like that. And another plus side is that during this whole scan line, we can do some actual stuff. Right, so we get a little bit more time to do actual CPU processing. So the effective resolution is then 160 by 120 in VGA. Yeah, right, so over here, a blank line, we can just at the start of the blank line put all zeros in the output register, and it will continue to output the zeros during the whole scan line, and in the meantime, the processor can do other stuff.
It's just a real graphics, and it's not the text buffer.
No, it's not the text buffer, it's real graphics, yeah. So here you see the RGB test with RGB lines, with we have 2 bits for each, so 6-bit RGB. So here you see all the possibilities of RGB output.
Noisy.
Yeah. So this is all that's needed to get VGA on the system. So it's an output buffer chip, and we have nine resistors to generate the analog VGA signal. So this is the first prototype board we hooked up on the first PCB, and it worked right away. It's interesting. It shows the picture of itself on the breadboard. Now we also have the RAM memory, so the addressing mode that we have with the automatical increment of the X register is really useful for bit binging data from RAM onto the VGA output. And actually, if we had to get that information from ROM, then copy it over and then put it out onto the bus, that would be too slow. So we can do this from RAM. And the interesting fact is, because we don't have, because the X just increments and overflows back to zero, we can just loop through that bank. And this makes it really easy to do scrolling. I mean, if I just start a little bit further up in the bank, in the memory, then it will just scroll over the end and go back to the beginning.
Also easy for repeating those three lines.
Yeah, it's also easy to repeat stuff, yeah. In reality, we only use the bottom half. It's a 32 kilobyte RAM chip. And in reality, we don't use the whole row because we only have 160 pixels that we output. And in fact, the bottom page we also don't use because that's a zero page. That's really so we have this addressing mode where we are addressing directly into the zero page. So we have VGA output, which is interesting, but we don't have the blinking lights, and we also want to have blinking lights. So can we do a little bit more to get more output on the system? You know, if we have the sync signal during the sync, the RGB output is not used. We have RGB output in the output buffer, but it's not used to make pixels. So if we use that data at that time to do something else, we can have more output. So we piggyback some extra outputs onto the VGA output and the sync signals. So every time 8 bits can be put in the output register, during normal VGA operations, this is used to drive the pixel colors, but during the syncs, we use this to drive the output to, well, we chose to use 4 bits for blinking lights, so we have 4 LEDs, and 4 bits with a DAC to do some audio. It's not super speedy, of course, because you only have a few sync pulses where you can do stuff, but it's perfectly suited for basic audio, or actually rather nice audio and the lights. So that works really, really well. So here we have an extra chip for the extended output, and we have the blinking lights and the audio DAC on top.
Sample rate is in 20 kilohertz or something approximately? Or?
I don't know.
So, okay. So line.
How about input? We have this input chip, we have an input buffer, so we can input 8 bits. So instead of some buttons, maybe we can use a controller. So we looked around on the internet and we found the controller on the top left, which is a Famicom controller. Famicom is a cheap clone of the Nintendo. But the advantage is that the Nintendo uses a really weird plug, and the Famicom uses a standard DB9 plug. So that's more easy to use. So We use this device, and we bought a few, and we did some tests, and it appears that if you you need to send a pulse, and then you can read out a register that's inside of the controller bit by bit to read the 8 bits for the 8 buttons on the thing. So how do we do this? We need, so it's pretty complicated. We need to send a bit and we need to read out 8 bits. How do we do this? We can piggyback this to the sync signals as well. I mean, we have every screen, we have one VSync. If you just send the VSync also to the Famicom controller, that means that every frame, it sends a signal to read out the controller. But now we also need to shuffle in all the bits from the controller, so we use the HSync. So every HSync, it asks the controller to give a bit. So after eight scan lines, we have inputted all the 8 bits, and then we need to make sure that in software we wait 8 scan lines until we get the whole byte of information from the controller.
How do you keep that in sync? Because my shift, or is it, how is it synchronized that you know that the start of this polling?
The start of the polling is piggyback to the VSync signal. So that's just in hardware.
Yeah, okay. So,
so for the polling, there's nothing that needs to be done in software.
No.
In software, I just need to make sure that I wait and get the result between scan line 8 and the last scan line. So that's over here. So that's also quite simple. It's just a few components, and we have input. So what have we got? We have got a CPU-less microcomputer. It runs at 6.25 megahertz. It's a RISC architecture, so one instruction, one thing to do. We have put in 32K of RAM on it. There's VGA output, we have some lights, we have some audio. And the interpreter takes away the burden of getting all the timing right and doing all the stuff with the far jumps and stuff like that. So software. So about the software. Say you want to program something for the Gigatron. There's actually two approaches you can do. First, you can have the approach of writing software offline on your laptop, compile it once, and put it onto the EEPROM. But we chose approach two, which is we compile software written in a somewhat higher language, and then burn that intermediate language into the EEPROM together with an interpreter. No, that's option three, compile software written in a somewhat higher language with an interpreter in an intermediate format and burn it to the EEPROM. Yeah, so number one was too difficult, and we opted for three, but two is also a possibility. So this somewhat high level language is the Gigatron control language, GCL. Some people have heard of GCL, another waveform. So on the left you see an example. It looks a bit like FALSE, a language that inspired BrainFuck and other languages. And FALSE was used by Wozniak, I believe. No?
Yeah.
Oh, no, sorry, that was a lot newer. That was from the 90s. And here you see an example of a language program in that language. So then we need an interpreter, and the interpreter actually emulates some sort of a virtual PC on the board. So the language that you use to program the board thinks there is a virtual CPU, thinks that there are 16-bit, that there is a 16-bit architecture. You can do 16-bit arithmetic using a virtual accumulator, and the interpreter takes care of translating that to stuff that runs on the actual board. And that's where Steve Wozniak comes in, because that's a bit like Sweet 16, which Steve Wozniak wrote also to cover the gap between 16-bit arithmetic and 8-bit. He also had an 8-bit computer, and he wanted to do 16-bit calculations, so he used a scheme like this for the Apple II. So the result is that from a software perspective, this is a 16-bit CPU using the Van Neumann architecture. So it's really interesting, because the hardware is an 8-bit CPU using the Harvard architecture. But using the software, we kind of virtualized this.
How did you write the interpreter? In assembly or in a high-level language that's compiled in assembly? Or with an interpreter to an interpreter?
No, that's all basic instructions for this system. Yeah. So this is what it can do. And I'll give a live demo later on.
No, it's fake.
So I think that's pretty impressive for a board of this size. Yeah. Actually, if you look at the hardware, does anybody know what it is there on the top left? It's a Hercules video card.
Ah, okay.
It's actually bigger than our computer. And on the top left is
Commodore 64.
Yeah, Commodore 64. So it's also bigger. And if you look at, there's quite a few hobbyists like us that are trying to build an interesting computer board, hobby board. And you see that some of them, they need a microprocessor chip, which for us is not interesting enough. So this, like the Commodore 64. Some need multiple boards. Actually, there is a great project of a guy who built a computer out of diodes, no transistors, sorry, transistors. And he uses plenty of boards, of course, but we wanted to have one board. And there are computers that are one board and has no microprocessor, but in most cases they are pretty limited in what they can do. So they have just a basic I/O and no audio video. So we are combining this single board, no CPU, but VGA output and audio output and input. Now we've come this far, so the idea is now to have a few of them made in Git form. So we also did some work for that, so we thought we need a good manual for that, so we've written a 45-page manual to build it all together. We have cases made, so this is just a prototype case that we have now. So that's the next step that we are going to do, and if you want to be informed, there's a mailing list you can subscribe to on gigatron.io. So now we have a lot of time for questions.
When does the Kickstarter start?
We don't have a Kickstarter. So we have to order a few cases and do some work on figuring out how to send the stuffing and get all the components. So maybe in January, February. We hope to sell a few.
I saw that you could jump between your own page. If you have to jump to another page, you use your
branch never.
Now the branch never, which is modified to a
far
branch. But doesn't that mean that if you have to go to a run memory location, you have to do two branches? But since you preload your next operation, that if you branch, that you have a chance that you read an instruction that you're not planning to read?
No, because you determine what's behind the branch instruction.
Yes, but say you have a branch and then you want to have a far jump.
All right.
So you add a branch, then the branch jumps to a certain bit in your memory. The next one is the far jump, so then it far jumps to the different page. But it already read the next instruction, which was in the same page, at the different place where you were. So how do you make sure that you don't start randomly executing instructions that are somewhat near where you want to go?
That I'll ask to the guru, the house guru.
Well, the computer will always do exactly what you programmed in it, so it is always deterministic. Mm-hmm. But you can get a case where you have a branch going somewhere, fetch an execution, but then the second branch will take care, which basically means that you have one instruction executed, and then you go to another location. And actually, we use that a lot to make lookup tables, because you can do very easily jump to somewhere and then immediately jump out of the lookup table, and in between you get a value out of it, for example. So it's pipelining tricks. We can do a lot of things that you cannot do in other CPUs, just to work around the limitations of the hardware. But you have to keep always in mind what is happening when you're programming it. So it's a little bit nasty to program.
I think when you have basically the far jump, you basically you're shifting your position horizontal in the memory and vertically in the memory.
Yeah, that's all the same tick.
So you do those both in the same tick.
Yeah. So what you do is first you preload the page register.
The Y register.
That's just the Y register. That this computer doesn't know what's happening, and then you do the far jump. And then the Y register, together with your D or your operand, will make a single jump in one cycle. And the total will take two cycles.
It's not the jump to the other page, and then the jump to the correct
It's just one jump.
One cycle, you update the whole program counter.
Okay, because I didn't see an instruction for that.
Yeah, that is the jump. That's the branch always instruction. We rewired that. That's always.
Just the wiring gets the higher side and the D for the low side.
Okay.
Or the bus or the D.
You can choose actually. There are, you can do that in various ways. Okay. Yeah, but the high bit always comes from the wire register.
I didn't see actually a shift left or right.
No, it's not in there. So we have to use lookup tables.
Okay. Ouch.
Oh, you use a multiply by two.
Yes, okay.
What was the reason to use the two ROM chips? And maybe could you also use one ROM chip and just have the operand at the even address and the instruction at the...
Well, it is now. You can do that. But then you need two cycles to read the whole instruction, and that adds complexity.
Okay,
so that's the only reason why they didn't do that. You need a state to remember what you are doing, or get it from the flow.
Yeah, be doubled to the execution frequency. Okay.
Yeah. This is just a 16-bit EEPROM.
And
maybe it's sacrilegious, but could this also not be a very efficient implementation in an FPGA to use this architecture? Because you have relatively little gates.
Probably.
Yeah.
It's not nearly as much fun.
Okay. you can do both. Eh? I mean, this is the hardware version. And if you have an FPGA version, you can use a very tiny device relatively.
Yes.
It will be very easy.
You can emulate it on your phone. Yeah. That's not the point.
You want to emulate the FPGA or?
Also.
That is great.
Just a logic detail simulator on your phone.
The instruction decode with diodes instead of 4 gates?
Because that saves a lot of chips. At some point, you need to cram the possibilities that you have to control the computer into a few bits. You have to decode it. And the logic is quite arbitrary. Those lookup tables that are now in the diodes, they are not very regular. So if you do that in TTL, you end up with a lot of chips. And the alternative is to use a ROM, but the ROMs are very slow. And this is not a lot of data. So we just used 30 diodes to combine. So you actually see the truth table of the operations. You see that the ones and the zeros, you see them in the form of diodes.
So how big is the matrix of this input-output of this decoding matrix?
They're two small decoding diodes, and it is, I can count here, they're both 8 by 5 or 6, and it's half populated. The density is about 50%, so there's half of them are diodes, and when there's no diode, it's a zero. It works exactly as a ROM, with a diode and a decoder.
Yeah, otherwise you would be using those small ROMs that the Apple II uses.
Yeah, and they are really slow. You cannot. This has to work within a couple of nanoseconds. Otherwise, and the ROMs they work at more than 100 nanoseconds. So I could not make it fast enough only with diodes.
And about the propagation time, how fast can you clock it?
This one is clocked, the cycle is 160 nanoseconds, and that is comfortable. I think you can push it to 8, and if you use a little bit faster generation of TTL, you might be able to push it to 10 megahertz.
But then the VGA timing would be off.
Then you have to rewrite the software to match the VGA signal again.
Maybe also interesting, the Famicom controller, does it have an input again, so you can you daisy chain them and just have 4 controllers in daisy chain?
And the chip that is in there has that because it is just a shift register that is in the controller, but it is not hooked. It is not
so it has 9 pins, 2 for the clock, 1 for the data, VCC, ground, and then 4 unconnected.
Only 5 of them are connected.
Cheap plugs.
Yeah. They just use them because it is a cheap plug.
But you can always make a breakout, so put them yourselves in series, and then you have to.
But the daisy chaining, it is not. There's no wire in the cable that that allows you to daisy chain it. Yeah. So you have to open it and
this is also an epoxy.
Oh, there's no input data.
No, it's not. It's in the chip, but it's not exposed on the
that's
connector.
Shame.
Yeah, that's a shame. Yeah.
Or just redesign your own. you can also create some serial keyboards.
The
so
controller has the same thing.
Do they
have wired it?
It's the same thing, but they have an expensive connector.
Yeah.
That's the point.
Yeah, that's the only reason why we bought these. Yeah, you can look up something else, of course. I want to be able to load software into the RAM through the serial port. Why not?
That was my question. Could you load software in because now you can't execute from RAM.
The interpreted code runs from RAM.
Oh yeah, okay.
And
of course, yeah.
That means that the serial port can put data into RAM. So in principle, the high level code you can load it through the serial port without burning the EEPROM.
There's no
support yet. Project to do that with an Arduino or something.
So also the limit to 8 bits for the input port is just done in software. Just cut the first 8 video lines, and then done. And you can input 16 or 32 or whatever 128 lines.
Yeah,
well,
if your input contains quite efficiently put a lot of bits in there. Yeah.
If you want to do it really retro, you have to make an audio input.
Yeah,
right. Basic code interpreter. But it's also something we wanted is to look like and be like an old system and a system that you can understand by looking at it. So
yeah.
That's also why we have the diodes, and also why there's an EEPROM and another ROM.
Mm-hmm.
And it just and you know the only ugly thing is the micro USB thing, but
for power.
It's a mini USB.
No
EEP ROM.
No.
Is it run 5 volts or 3.3?
5.0.
Yeah. 5.0.
Yeah. So it matches very nicely with USB. So we don't have a power regulator on it. It's not necessary. But that was easy.
You do put decoupling caps
everywhere.
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
Well, you could always. I see that you have something on the EEPROM on
give it.
Around?
Yeah, this is my development board, so I put a ZIF socket on it. I changed
quite
the ROMs quite a bit. Yeah.
But you can also put some daughter board in it and put two flash ROMs on it, something next to
each
other, or 16-bit flash. Set up there.
Yeah, this is a prototype board, so it has a few errors still.
Like this?
Yeah, like that. But still not bad for a first try.
Where did you get some boards produced?
We tried a couple of vendors in China and one in Europe. And, they're all equivalent. And this is very simple two-layer board, so it's, everybody can make it.
Oh, wow.
Very low hidden layers.
No.
There's no ground plane
in it, or
it's
EMC-wise, it's not
very. It is flat fill on the.
Yeah, you can simulate the radio
with
it. It's
so fair. Well, traditional one side is ground fill, other side is VCC fill.
Both sides where I fill, I do a ground fill. So I try to fill as much as possible as the open area with ground.
Still quite nice thick.
I use VCC fill on one side and ground on the other side.
Okay.
To I don't have two VCCs.
Yeah.
Did you look at other CPU architectures like PDP-11? Yeah, sure.
Of course.
PDP-8.
Yes.
So you have no stack?
No.
You can do a stack in software. So it takes a couple of extra, but you have all the kind of indirect addressing where you can get an address from a register. So with that you can do a stack. But for the simple video games, you can always put things at fixed locations, so you almost never need it. There is a guy now writing a chess program for that, and he will need a check. Stack.
Hey, somebody maybe.
Our Geert is there. That's the guy. So you have to get creative with the addressing modes, but there's no, you can make recursive functions if you like.
Yeah, try to port MicroPython or something.
Because most original home computers having tokenized BASIC instead of this virtual computer, is this also something you considered?
The working title for the interpreter was basic,
okay,
but yeah, it turned out to be some homebrew own thing.
Okay.
That,
When did you start building, and when, where are you now?
The ID started end of December last year. And the breadboard version was working, I think, somewhere in March. That was quite fast, actually. And then the PCB version took 3 months. And the last 3 months we have been working on upgrading this to something that is will work as a kit. And I'm writing the video software games now. So it's, that's my work is now just making the software. That's,
and should it be considered as spousal abuse? It's
not that bad.
It's almost done, and I don't want to do it again. It's, it's a lot of work.
It's basically the only reason that this didn't came out in the mid-70s, because RAM was so expensive, or?
Yeah, two things. I think the RISC architecture itself was not very, it was invented or became known at the end of the 1970s, and before that people put architectures that they had, like the PDP-8 or PDP-11, on their microprocessor, and then they were stuck with that because all the software had to be compatible with the older processors. The RAM, of course, it was four times, it was extremely expensive, so, but in 1980s that was there. It was also a little bit slower at the time. But also TV signals were a lot slower, so I think that evens out a little bit. So I think you could make it in 1970s and 80s, but it would be very expensive because of the RAM.
Yeah, 4K was like something like 100 guilders or something.
Yeah, like, the Atari game system, it had only 265 bytes to run video games from. Otherwise it was not affordable.
2600 had only one display line,
yeah,
of
one
memory.
Yeah, yeah.
And uses the read phase to calculate an X line or something.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, but you could make it if you say, okay, you did also not have VGA, so VGA asks a lot of speed. So if you put it in that area, then you would make composite output and you would clock it a little bit lower, make a little bit different architecture.
You could have created a basically dedicated VGA interface just with display RAM and clock it also with TTL.
Yeah, that was one of, but then you need about twice as much chips. So that is one reason why I choose this design. The original idea was to have the VGA part and then a little 4-bit processor next to it, but you get many more chips than I have now. So basically this, I threw away the video card and do the video card and software.
Also why the 10 chips and not the 181?
That was just because it is fun. That is,
That's also something that they didn't, I think it's pretty recent that this German guy wrote about how you can do an ALU using.
Yeah, the ALU design. It's not mine, it's somebody invented it.
It's a really interesting design using really a low component count. Yeah. But it's also, it adds up to the educational value of seeing how stuff works.
And if you want to develop software, are there still in-circuit emulators or APROM emulators which you can easily hook up?
I use an emulator for most of my work, and I check that the timing is good, and then I put it in there.
You use a software emulator, you mean hardware
APROM emulator, so you can
They are rare to find and really expensive. So
you can build them.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, SRAM with some,
but it's easier to just do your stuff in software, and if it works,
burn it.
Do you still have any unused gates?
Yes, one multiplexer. Actually, one of the chips has two multiplexers in it, and I use only one of them. And the nasty thing, some of the inputs are really shared between those two, but you could still use them as an inverter. So I could still do something there. There is the only reason the memory is 32 kilobytes is because that's the standard chip size. but I have a breakout for the high address line, so if you want to increase the memory to 64, it should not be very difficult. Probably you can use that inverter and also do something with the addressing and then upgrade it to a higher memory.
I have a few 128k static RAM chips, so and you can use it, kind of switch on it, use the spare multiplexer to swap between the low and the high.
Are there any ways to connect persistent storage to this computer?
The EEPROM.
The EEPROM. I found out that if you switch off the board, then it will keep its memory for quite a long time. Because of the capacitors that are on it. Because the memory is CMOS, it stays intact for a very long time. But there are battery powered RAMs that you can plug in.
Those horrible Dallas ones with the built-in battery?
So they're a little bit expensive to my taste, but you could do something like
A little bit expensive, and they have the tendency to break your equipment when it's been in the closet for 15 years. You take it out, and suddenly it's broken.
But if you have, for example, SD card in SPI mode, then you should be able to actually output something that maybe you need a serial peripheral.
Well, you have the input, and is there a serial output something stuffy? No, you can.
Well, you can use the LEDs for that.
Optocouple, one of the blinker lights. Yeah.
In the mid-1990s, I built a darkroom timer, which basically had a storage to 2K static RAMs, and those had powered off a 4.5 volts battery. I think it will still keep its memory in until the heat death of the universe.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
Until the battery dies.
Until the battery dies.
Yeah,
or even some leaky radiation.
But having battery backup for your CMOS RAM is dead easy.
Yeah.
Because basically you can run it off the battery even if the rest of the system is running off the USB power.
So it's very hackable for
the... Yeah, it's nice. It's all simple stuff, and it's no problem if I do this.
About the availability of the parts, is there still a problem for TTL chips or in the packages?
There's no problem now. It might be in the future when everything goes to SMD.
Yeah,
but as it is now. You still have the same functionality in SMD.
Yeah, but we really wanted it to look like...
Yeah, okay, but even if you can't get the chip you want in... in DIL, you can have one or two on as SMD and have converter board. You can.
I think they'll be made for quite some time.
Yeah.
And then for quite some time, Chinese people in the streets will solder out with the soldering iron and sell them on eBay.
Yeah. Probably. Yeah.
There's just some rare chips that just have been stopped in the 80s.
Yeah, the ALU chips, for example, they don't have a function anymore, so they're not produced anymore. But all these simple chips, they still have functions in a lot of designs. Nexperia is still making them.
The EEPROMs are not very common this size, but
also, you said in your sheets and your talk sometimes it's without a CPU. But I believe it is a CPU.
It's without a single chip CPU.
It's without a microprocessor.
Without
a single chip CPU. Because it is a CPU.
Yes.
I do see on the image Gigatron TTL microcomputer.
The beamer cuts off the left and the right side.
The projector cuts it off.
Or something.
This is a little program I wrote this morning in the high level language. And this is the first time I can write text on the screen because I didn't have the font data in the ROM yet, and I forgot to put the spacing between the letters, you see, so they all spread together.
The sideways problem was not always available in the 80s.
Yeah, because this is easy with this hardware.
Yeah.
The interpreter only has to update the start position, and then it is.
Yeah, the rest moves. Also, the sheets were cut off at the left side.
Yeah, the sheets were cut off, that was not...
widescreen conversion, but went wrong.
And in the current processor can only execute one instruction per clock cycle. Can you also imagine an architecture which can execute multiple instructions per clock cycle, or is this too... Well,
it
would be immensely more
complicated.
I'll
use two of those.
Right. I think that makes sense. Yeah, you can, could do something like that. Yeah.
But it's already pipelined. So every clock cycle there is...
Every chip is always doing something during every instruction.
Because I think in Z80 there were actually 4 clock cycles per instruction plus a wait cycle, the wait state.
Yes.
And this is really per every instruction there is a fetch and then the another stage...
It's also what you call a clock cycle and a CPU cycle could be different. You can say, well, I have some divider, so this the clock is at 20 megahertz and my CPU runs at 5 because I use some timing stuff in the other 4 ticks or other 3 ticks of the crystal.
Yeah.
We didn't want to have a micro states because that adds chips. So you see that in all the other similar projects, they have some state machine in there, but that immediately adds a lot of complexity to the design. So that's the only reason that we.
Oh, you have to put in even more ROMs. or FPGAs.
And also, no multiply instruction anywhere could be fine. Well, in the 1980s, it was always on the software.
You don't need that for games.
No floating point support.
You could make a library.
Everything with library. But there were special instructions that did, I think, BCD decoding to decimal. Or there were some special ways to...
I know the 6502 or something, or the 10, had some BCD. Switch over so they can count in BCD instead of binary. So.
Very nice.
All right.
Just a 10